There's a story of two friends who went to church together. One was a Black Baptist, the other was a Catholic. And so it was an experience for the both of them. And they started asking each other, what is this? Why does the priest lift the cup this way? Why does the choir sing this way? Why does the pastor preach so long in the Black Baptist church, but in the Catholic church, there's just a 10-minute homily? But there was something that happened at the Black Baptist church. Before the pastor began to preach, he took off his watch, and the friend asked the question, what is he doing? Why is he taking off his watch? Is he mindful of the time? The friend said, I don't know why he's doing that. Honestly, it means nothing. Sometimes in life, we have to experience different things, especially in our conversion process, especially when we are walking with Jesus. The sermon title this morning is Experiencing God, but if I can add a subtitle, Experiencing Jesus works as well. This morning, in honor of Pastor Steve, I have a quote from A Song of Ascents by E. Stanley Jones. In his chapter, The Aftermath of Conversion, he says, another adjustment was not quite so easy, his adjustment to the faith. It had labor pains accompanying it before the birth, a birth into freedom. So I haltingly said, why, Lord? Oh, Lord, of course, I'm following you. Jesus had asked E. Stanley Jones, are you following me? You see, E. Stanley Jones had a mentor, Mr. Bateman, to where he led E. Stanley to Christ. And E. Stanley was holding on to every word, every movement, like any young preacher does to their mentor. But E. Stanley Jones had to come to the conclusion that I cannot focus on Christ and also focus on Mr. Bateman. He said, I began to stop gazing at Mr. Bateman, and I only glance at him now. For I gaze at Jesus and no longer glance at him. That's a word for somebody this morning. As we live in the age of information, as we live in the age of breaking news, as we live in the age of social media where everything and everybody has something to say, that can get confusing. That can allow us to get off course. That can make us distracted and not focus on, as Jalen Hurts says, the main thing. Sometimes you got to keep the main thing the main thing. Church, we're in the middle of a transition. Each and every one of you are transitioning in some way, shape, or form in life. Our young people are getting ready to go back to school. Routine is beginning to be a thing again. We no longer have the freedom of the summer. Well, we have 2 more weeks. I'm not going to depress anybody this morning. But we're all transitioning in some way, shape, or form. But the question is, what are you holding on to? What are you experiencing? Are you allowing yourself to be stable in your faith and what you believe? But most importantly, what God is calling you to. The disciples had a beautiful experience with Jesus. Although it was not all 12 of them, Jesus was very particular on who he chose, Peter, James, and John. And they went up to the mountain, the text tells us. Luke records for us on the 8th day. The 8th day has significance in Scripture, mainly because we know that 7 days means completion. But the 8th day represents a new beginning, a new day, a new opportunity. My dear friends, I know each and every one of you have, in some way, shape, or form, some kind of new opportunity that awaits you. As a matter of fact, when God touched you with a finger of love this morning, you had a new opportunity to see a brand new day. When you looked into your closet, there was many of clothes that you could have chosen, but You chose the select clothes that you have on right now. You chose the direct route that you were going to make to Narberth Presbyterian Church this morning. You chose particularly the seat that you were going to sit in. What is influencing you? What is allowing you to be you? Jesus took his disciples on the mountain. You see, Jesus has a way of allowing us to follow him. As a matter of fact, that's his mission. That's his mission, but also his disciples' mission as well. The first question he asked them is, do you want to follow me? And then after they gave their answer, okay, follow me. I'm going to make you fishers of men. We have a ministry to get started. We have a mission to go on. And so Jesus took them to the mountain. But as we heard earlier, he also took them into the garden. See, the garden and the mountain are a great dichotomy for joy and pain, sunshine and rain. See, we have our high moments in life, but we also have our low moments as well. We can see Jesus in his glory on the mountain, but we also can see the bloody face of Jesus in agony. There's always going to be the dichotomy of happiness and pain in life. But the question is, what are you holding on to? What are you standing true to? We're looking for a new pastor. We're looking for a new leader. Never negating the ministry of Pastor Steve whatsoever. Not forgetting his leadership. But as we look forward, what are we looking for? What is on our hearts for a pastor? Well, Jesus reminds them, well, Moses and Elijah was on the mountain. Moses and Elijah were talking to Jesus and having a conversation. These two influencers of the faith, Moses and Elijah, the lawgiver, and as one of my favorite professors says, the dean of prophecy. Moses and Elijah were given permission by God to come to earth one last time. And they sat with Jesus while he was in the midst of praying. How does it look for you while you're praying? How does your heart feel in the midst of your talking to God? Before we go any further, do you talk to God? Do you allow for yourself the quiet time to sit with God? See, sometimes in our fast-paced lives, we can forget our relationship with the Lord. Sometimes we can forget the devotion that is most important for us. Even me, preaching behind this pulpit this morning, can forget the closeness of God and what he means to me and what he's calling me to. Are you experiencing Jesus? We're in the gospel according to Luke, the 9th chapter. Luke has this chapter kind of catty-cornered in this book, and he focuses merely on the disciples, the conversations between Jesus and his disciples in this chapter. We see many things happening, such as Jesus sending out the 12 apostles, Jesus feeding the 5,000, Peter confessing Jesus the Christ, Jesus foretelling his death, Jesus telling his disciples, if you're going to follow me, you're going to have to take up your cross. But then he doesn't leave them in a somber state after he tells them that I'm going to die, but also you have a cross that you have to bear as well. He doesn't leave them there. As a matter of fact, he takes them to the mountain. He allows them to see something different on the 8th day, a new thing. What is the new thing that God is taking you to or God is allowing you to see? Jack so graciously told us this morning the results of what happened and what is going on inside of the PNC meetings. We had someone come and it was nice. He was cool. But he wasn't chosen. And the reason being is because We understood what the church needed, but we also knew who we were serving. We're a relational church. We love on one another. We understand what Jesus says, that to be my disciples, you have to love one another. We understand the vision of intergenerational ministry, not allowing ourselves to separate, but for all of the generations of the church to be influenced and influence. Are you experiencing Jesus? First, we see in the text that the disciples follow Jesus. Jesus calls us to different places. But we also see that we're going to see some things. The disciples saw Elijah and Moses. That probably shocked them. They were asleep. They woke up. And these two random people talking to Jesus. Jesus, who are they, these people? Why are they here? And what is their significance? As they're rubbing their eyes, they start to get a clear picture as to who it is. But if you read the text, they're really looking at Jesus. They're not necessarily seeing Moses and Elijah. They know they're there, but they're looking at Jesus. We know that someone's coming to become the pastor. We know that Pastor Steve will have a message for us. This morning, you all knew that Jawan was going to have a message for you. But at the end of the day, we need to be seeing Jesus. We have to be able to see Jesus in his splendor so that we can be able to go day by day, not allowing ourselves to be swindled by the philosophies of life, not allowing ourselves to be distracted by what they say or he say or she say or whoever says. There's so much confusion the world offers, but Christ offers clarity. He says, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. One of the first things that I learned coming to the main line was that y'all fast. I mean, I thought Philly was fast. Y'all keep it going. And with that, I had to adjust my pace. I thought that I was, you know, very fast paced. I was able to, you know, in some way, shape, or form, hang with the best of them in Philadelphia. But I came to Narberth, I can't even keep up with the kids. But sometimes in life, we have to realize what our true purpose is and see it for what it is. I'm here to not keep up with, but tell our youth, although you have all these different things and you're busier than some adults, make sure you take some time to slow down and actually see what God is showing you. Make sure that you're following God in everything that you do. Because this has been some times, and I've told you all this, that I've tried to follow Jawan, and Jawan just leads me down the path of unrighteousness. But Jesus is calling us to a fresh start, to a new anointing, to a new day, to a brighter future. Just like the disciples were able to experience Jesus and his splendor and his glory on the mountain. What is your mountain experience? What is God showing you? But in order for you to see it, you first have to follow. And lastly, we're looking to Jesus. But most importantly, are we listening to Christ? I told you that we're living in an age of information. Things are getting sent to us at a millisecond. A millisecond. Seems like every time I look at the New York Times, and yes, I'm an old man, I read the New York Times. It seems like there's always breaking news or a live report. Something new always going on, trying to be in the know. But what is Jesus saying above all of that? What is he saying over the noise? Dr. Wyatt T. Walker, former pastor of Canaan Baptist Church in New York, and Dr. Martin Luther King's chief of staff, he was preaching and he said, sometimes we don't know how to differentiate hearing things and listening. Hearing things, you just it's just noise. We're able to hear something. But listening, listening includes the mind. Because as you listen, you also have to think and be able to comprehend what's being said. You can listen to the organ and not really understand the notes that are being played, but you can feel it inside of you. You can hear the noise about the Eagles going to win the Super Bowl and the Phillies are going to try to make a run for it. But does that really help you on where you're going? It's good for some entertainment, but is it something that you're supposed to allow to latch on to? As a young boy, I latched on to the Philadelphia Eagles, and I'm going to tell you now, it was a sad story for me. But I found that listening to Jesus is such a beautiful experience because he says things that allows for you to be encouraged even in your weakest moments. He allows for you to be able to experience the highest of heights while you're in the lowest of depths. I think Paul says it like this: I was able to go to the third heaven, but when I came back to reality, there was a thorn in my flesh. And I asked God, God, take this thorn away from me. Well, his grace is sufficient. But sometimes we have to be able to experience the thorns in life to be able to better understand that third heaven experience. See, Christ is going to take you to the highest mountain. But as we listened to earlier, and as I mentioned earlier, he also takes us to the Garden of Gethsemane and the Garden of Sorrows. He also allows for us to see him both in his splendor, but also in his agonizing death. And that's the same for you. Sometimes you in your lives are going to experience the mountaintop moments, the wedding, the graduation, the birth of your child, et cetera, et cetera. But there also are going to be some dark nights of the soul. There's also going to be some nights where you're going to go into your room and close the door and turn the lights off and just cry with your face to the ground, trying to get a hold of yourself. He takes us to the mountain, but he also takes us to the garden. And although we are going to have our great moments, let me encourage you in your low moments. May you not allow yourselves to get too caught up in the garden of sorrows or the garden of Gethsemane. But may you allow your souls to sing. I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. Church, I'm so happy that he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me that I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. This is just a meditation to allow you to experience Jesus better. God bless you and God keep you is my prayer.